All right, so let's start. Welcome everyone to our C++ programming lecture. So my name is Philipp Schubert and this is the first lecture, or actually in computer science you would say it's the zeroth lecture, because computer scientists always start counting at zero, as you will learn during this lecture if you not already know. All right, let's switch the windows. So the C++ programming language, it's known to be a very easy language. In fact, so easy that there exists the following saying. So C++ is easy, it's like riding a bike, really, except the bike is on fire. Not too bad, but you are on fire too, and everything is on fire because actually you are in hell. So but if you are fine with that, so then the C++ programming language will be very easy for you. So this will be all fine. Of course, it's a bit of a joke, but surely C++ is not the easiest language to learn, but we'll try to make good progress. So, and I hope I'll teach you well. If you have any questions, of course, there exists the forum in Panda where you can ask questions anytime. The problem here with those kind of lecture recordings is that we do not have an interactive environment. Usually, if I give a lecture in front of an audience, you can shout out anytime and ask your questions, or ask me to clarify certain things and points. We do not have this ability here, so it's a bit unfortunate, but let's try to make use of the forum in Panda, and I guess we'll make it work somehow. Okay, so a junior C++ developer, that will be probably you during the beginning of this course, and probably also in midterms of this course. So you step on a fork, and then immediately the fork jumps right in your face. That's the ordinary case. At the beginning, at the end of the lecture or of this course here, it's probably be more like this one here. So a senior C++ developer does cool stuff, but at the very end, sometimes C++ can bite you, and it could be even me on this bottom picture here. All right, so let's start with let's stop being silly. So let's start with the lecture. What are the contents of today's lecture? We will, of course, talk a bit organizational matter. It's somewhat boring, but we have to do it, right? So we will also discuss the course outline. So what will be taught in this course? The details may vary, but I mean, the overall course outline will be presented here and will be pretty much fixed. We'll also talk about the history of C++, so how C++ developed as a programming language, where it came from and where it probably goes to. We will talk about C++ compilers. You will learn today that C++ is a compiled language, so we need some magical programs called compilers. Later on, we will reach that point in today's lecture. We will also write our first Hello World program. So a Hello World program is probably the first program that you implement, that you write if you learn a new programming language. Also, we'll talk about how to set up a development environment such that you can write some code and compile it, and finally also execute your handwritten programs. And we also start with basic terms and concepts at the very end. So we'll talk about variables, about literals. So what is a literal? Because those are the very basic primitives that you need to start writing programs, that you really need if you wish to start writing programs. Organization. So rooms, it will be a bit different. So we are not in the lecture hall C2. Now that is not going to happen due to the current situation. You all know about it, so I don't mention the name of that nasty thing anymore. So Regarding lectures, they will be recorded, so we will have such recordings as you see here. I will upload them to Panda, or at least I will give you the link via the Panda system from the university. I'll try to record the lectures and make them available on Fridays at approximately 2 o'clock. Sometimes maybe I'm a bit faster and I could record those lectures earlier, and then I'm maybe already going to upload those Friday morning. You just have to check, but it will be around 2 o'clock at the latest point in time, because you should get a good schedule such that you can really watch the recording at around 2 o'clock, and then we can continue with our exercise class. For the exercise class, we need a more interactive environment. As you see here now, you're just watching a recording. You can't really ask questions. That's very unfortunate. So for the exercise classes, we will have a live stream. So at least we try and see how it goes. The live stream will be on Fridays from 4 to 6 o'clock. So as the exercise class would be in usual in physical environment in C2, but we will do it as a live stream. Either we're going to try YouTube or we use Twitch, undecided yet. So I have to conduct some further investigation over the weekend, and I'll let you know by email what we're going to do, how that works, and I'll give you all the details that you need. Again, my name is Philipp Schubert. My office is located in F1206. That's probably not very relevant to you right now because of this current situation. The office is located in the Heinz Nixdorf Institute. Here's my email address, so you can send me an email anytime. I will also try to create a chat in Panda. So there's this chat functionality in Panda. We can also try out that and see, because then you can ask a bit more informal questions, and hopefully my response times are faster than via email. There will also be a website to this course, which is HNI Uni Paderborn DE SWT Lehre CPPP. C++ programming. So how about your experience? So you do not need any programming experience in order to attend to the course. Probably it's not going to hurt if you have some previous experience, but otherwise you should also be good to go. Let's see how it works. You need, of course, at least some basic knowledge on how to use a computer. I mean, here you need to have a look at the recording, on the lecture recordings. You should be able to use a text editor and write some text, edit some text files, because we will do that a lot in programming, as you will learn in this course. And also you should be able to operate one of the major operating systems, so Linux, Windows, or Mac OS. All right, so let's continue. Here is usually a map that I show when giving this course as a physical event. So when you need to go from Paderborn University to my office located in Heinz Nixdorf Institute, but I guess that's not very relevant for this whole semester, because it will probably all be handled online in a virtual way. Organization. So what are the benefits of attending to this course might be interesting to you. So you can be, as an outcome, you can be confident to take advanced courses that require C++. So many advanced courses do have that requirement. At least at Bielefeld University, where I studied a few years ago, many courses like computer graphics or machine learning or whatnot, they all used C or C++. Most of them used really C++. And it doesn't really hurt to know that language, really. It will help you in a lot of places. You will, of course, also be able to realize your own programming projects. I mean, I also kind of force you to realize programming projects because there will be weekly exercise sheets that you need to solve. And of course, as this is a programming course, you oftentimes will need to implement some functionalities, some minor programs, algorithms, and all that good stuff. So, and at the very end of the course, you will be able to write your own programs that do something useful, meaningful, that might be of help to you. It will also be very useful for your computational thinking. So, how to do stuff, how to accomplish stuff, because I mean, programming is basically telling the computer how to solve a certain problem, and there can't be any uncertainty if you tell the computer in form of a program, because the computer does not understand uncertainty. So you really have a sharp computational thinking. You need to express exactly what you wish to do, otherwise the computer won't be able to understand your problem and your algorithm which solves the problem. Also, you will improve your understanding on how a computer works. C++ is known to be a kind of it's not a low level language, it's a very powerful language which gives you access to all low level parts of your computer, to all hardware resources. So you will, for instance, learn that there are some different kinds of memory. There's stack memory, there's heap memory. But I guess you notice we are getting ahead of ourselves, so let's leave it be. Also, a very interesting point in life later on after your studies is probably well-paid jobs, because you have to pay your rent somehow. And C++ is really known to have some well-paid jobs. So if you have C++ programmer or C++ software engineer, I will show you at the very end of the lecture some job applications. So we'll go to a website and just type C++ programming, and we'll see what we could really apply for. And then you will see that there is a lot of money in for you. So be patient, take the pain of learning C++. It will pay off later on, definitely. And also keep in mind that later on in your life, I mean, this lecture for you and all this material and such, that's for free for you. I mean, the university pays me to do all that kind of stuff. And you can attend to this course and learn a new thing, learn C++, and it's completely free for you. Later on in your life, if you wish to take such courses on C++, for instance, here we see, so this is Boris Schäling, it's a C++ consultant. He gives some kind of courses, for instance, here he offers a masterclass. It's basically just one weekend, and you have to pay 2,500 euros, so quite a lot of money. And here you get it for free. So, and this also directly relates to well-paid jobs, because this guy offers such courses and he is making money out of that, and not too little, because those 2,500 euros are per person, per participant, of course. And if you talk in front of 100 people, you have some nice money at the very end of the day. Studium Generale, so SG. Let's talk about credit points. So students of computer science will not be able to receive credit points, so it's just a bonus course that you can take for your own fun and knowledge improvement, so to say. And also students of electrical engineering will not be able to receive any credit points for this course. If you are not a student of computer science and not a student of electrical engineering, so you probably will be able to receive credit points. When in doubt, really ask your examination office, because they can give you a clear statement on if you are allowed to receive credit points or not. So that being said, so most of the other students will receive 4 credit points. There are some rare cases where 4 credit points are not good enough, because you need 5 in order to get all your studying done. So in case you need one more credit point, like 5 instead of 4 credit points, please do send me an email. We can also make that work, but then of course you have to do some additional work that's worth 1 credit point, but that shouldn't be too much of a problem. So from time to time we have such cases. Please ping me by email. And everyone, of course, obtains a nice certificate, which you can put in your CV, which states your effort and your efforts put in this course and also your newly learned skills. So it really doesn't hurt to have such a nice certificate. Okay, so if you have not yet registered to this course, at least register to that course on Panda, because I need your email addresses such that I can reach out to you. Also, you need to be able to access this material, which you can do using Panda. So if you do not need to receive credit points, or you do not wish to receive credit points for this course, a registration on Panda is completely sufficient. If you do wish to receive credit points, and you are also allowed to receive credit points, you also need to register in Paul. So please be aware of that. Yeah, and I need your emails because I will oftentimes send additional material that might be helpful or interesting to you. For instance, you will receive 1 email tomorrow or over the weekend, and this email will contain a personal unique identifier. So each of you will receive an ID, and then using that ID you can look up your results on the exercise sheets using a link to a Google spreadsheet. Because I mean, surely I cannot put your names on the internet, but you will each receive a unique identifier, and then you can see how you perform, basically. All right, so let's start with the course outline. So basic introduction, that's what we are currently doing. So we will also talk about the history of C and C++ today. We will talk about compilers, development environments, basic terms and concepts of C++. Today and next lecture, we will talk about basic C++ programming. So what are primitive data types? What are more advanced data types like strings and vectors, which are not primitive anymore? Arrays, pointers. We will talk about expressions and statements, because essentially you need expressions and statements as the most basic building blocks to express your computations and your computational problems that you wish to have the computer solve for you. We'll also talk about structures, unions, enumerations, which you need to model your computational problem in a suitable manner. Structures let you, for instance, implement or craft your own data types, really. We'll talk about functions and classes. We will talk about the STL. So C++ comes with a standard template library. So that's a standardized library using templates. We'll learn later on what templates are, but in short, it's just the STL. It provides some input-output functionalities that you need to get some data into your programs, and you usually process it, and then you get this data out of the program, out of your program. It provides container types, generic algorithms, lots of good stuff. We'll talk about static and dynamic memory. It's very important. Nowadays, we can also talk about smart pointers, which come in quite handy to improve on your programs. And also, of course, we talk about advanced techniques too. So copy controls, standard class members, operator overloading. Operator overloading is actually a really neat thing, because if you do it in a sane manner, you can also do it in an insane manner, and so nobody will be able to read your program anymore. But if you use operator overloading in a sane manner, you will be able to write down your algorithms like in math textbooks. You can have 2 matrices, multiply them 2 together, and lots of that good stuff. So it really helps to improve code readability. C++ can also be considered, I mean, it has capabilities that allow you to program in an object-oriented manner. So we will talk about object orientation as well and object-oriented programming. And C++ would not be C++ if we do not have templates. So we will talk about templates. It doesn't matter if you don't know what that is yet, but it will allow you to do some very cool generic programming, which you cannot really do in any other language, because yeah, C++ is a really, really powerful language. And also very important, we will talk about useful libraries. OpenMP, OpenCV, OpenCL, OpenGL, nowadays it's called Vulkan. So you can use this library if you wish to implement some graphics application. So you could implement your own ego shooter or whatnot, or racing game, depends on your preferences. So there's also this library Qt if you need to implement some graphical implementations with some nice windows, and so your buttons you click and then magical stuff happening in your program. Google Test is also important to test your application. It's always good to test your functions that you're implementing. So there are some testing frameworks like Gtest, Google Test. There's Google's UpSci library, which comes with various features, functionalities, which you can use out of the box. There's the Boost library collections, really also a collection of a tremendous amount of useful functionalities, which you can just use off the shelf. And some other useful libraries. I will at least mention those libraries, and then you know where you could look up the desired information and how to use those libraries. Because the major point of libraries are, do not reinvent the wheel, use libraries. So if you need to accomplish a programming task, why should you come up with your own data structures? Why should you re-implement algorithms that other people already implemented and offer in terms of libraries? So just use existing stuff. Because it makes your development much more efficient and less error-prone, of course. Okay, coming to literature. So what could be a useful addition to this lecture here, for instance, and to the lecture slides? I uploaded to Panda a PDF, a tour of C++, which is written by Bjarne Straustrup, the initial creator of C++, so the father of C++, so to say. And it's a small booklet, around 180 pages. If you cut off the preface and all the other noise, you can really read it over one rainy weekend. So, and you can really kind of view this little book as the script to this lecture, where you can find some more details if interested, or you can read up and look up stuff that we discuss here in the lecture and read it and maybe get another perspective on things. So quite helpful, I guess. And it's very short, and it's quite helpful, I guess. There's also, for bloody beginners, there is a programming book, which is called Programming Principles and Practice Using C++, which is also by Straustrup, and it's very low level, starts at the very beginning also of computer programming using C++, as the title suggests. Then there's the Holy Bible of C++, the C++ programming language. In this book, you can find all the details on C++, but the problem is it's far beyond 1,000 pages. So, and you really don't read it from front to back. You just go to the certain topic, to the topic of interest to you, and read all the details about that, because it's not fun to read that book, because most of the time you're not interested in all the language specific details and that related stuff. Very important for this course is probably also the C++ reference. Every time that you use something from the STL, from the standard template library, which we are going to use a lot, I guess, in this course, then you can look up certain things on cppreference.com. So please check out this webpage, and you will find not only how it works, how stuff works, you will also oftentimes find neat examples which help you understanding stuff. So it's a good resource on C++ in general, and especially for the standard template library. And on YouTube, there's a channel for the CppCon conference. So there's a conference on C++, which is called CppCon. They have their own YouTube channel. They record, if I recall correctly, all of their talks, all of their conference talks, and thus you do not really need to attend the conference because it was a bit on the expensive side, and it is in Washington, if I recall correctly. So first of all, you would need to travel to the United States. But you don't have to deal with any of that. You can just look up the talks on YouTube. But beware, those are expert talks. And as a beginner, if you watch one of their talks, which is not a beginner's talk or not declared as a beginner's talk, you won't probably understand a single thing. So it's really advanced stuff. But might be interesting for one of you later on in this course, if you really are into that language. Also, another useful resource is Effective Modern C++ by Scott Myers. So also interesting, but also advanced stuff. So I mean, those bullet points are really ordered. So start at the beginning with a resource 1, 2, and 3 maybe, and 4, and 5 and 6 are more expert stuff. Now I made a mistake, because there's also a great online tutorial which you can have a look at. And it's also one of the beginner-friendly tutorials which you can check out, in addition to attending to those kind of lecture recordings here. So what's the message here? It's really important to have different input channels. So please do attend the lecture, even if it's just a recording. Please do the exercises. Besides, you have to do them anyway if you wish to obtain credit points and the certificate at the very end. So you need to achieve at least 50% of the overall exercise points to be admitted to the final project. But I mean, you should do the exercises anyways, because you can only learn a programming language if you program in that language. Otherwise, it doesn't help much, really. And also, within this lecture here, I'll try to make links to books and YouTube videos to related stuff, so you can also check out those. And sometimes I also mention YouTube links to very interesting talks on the exercise sheets, so you cannot really miss those hints and those links. And of course, talk to each other. So if one of you has a question, go ask this question on Panda. And you can also answer each other's questions. I also will, of course, have a look at the questions you ask, and I will answer as well if once I check them out. But you can also answer each other's question, of course, if you know the answer. All right, so regarding exercises, I already gave a bunch of information on weekly exercises. So there will be weekly exercises. There are some small theoretical parts, and there are, of course, a heavy duty practical exercise part, which you need to solve, really. So your hand-ins, your submissions to those exercises will get evaluated, and you need to achieve at least 50% during the semester overall points to be admitted to the final project. Then at the very end, once we have our final lecture and final exercise class, there will be a final project. So it's just similar to a bit bigger exercise sheet. So it will just be a textual description of a problem that you need to solve. Basically, you have to solve a small programming task. And if you successfully solve that programming task, you will be able to obtain the certificate and also the credit points, 4 or 5. Remember that email that you should send me if you need 5 instead of 4 ECTS. And so there will be no final exam. So you can view the final project as the final exam, so to say. Please do not copy each other's solution. I mean, you can check out this link. There's this great program which detects plagiarism, and it works really, really well. So we detected quite a lot of stuff in the past. So also do not just try to rename variable names, and so this software will detect it anyways. So please don't try. If you really don't understand something, yeah, unsure, I have doubts, just send me an email. We can work it out. But there's really no reason to copy each other's solutions. And also, you do not earn anything by doing that. So please don't. Also adhere to the notes on the exercise sheets. On each exercise sheet, I have a small paragraph, really, which states how to hand in solutions. Please adhere to that, because there are always people who get it wrong, who don't do it like that. And I will look at that one time, and if I observe it the second time that you can't adhere to how to hand in your solutions to the exercises, you will be awarded 0 points for them. For those solutions, because I mean the trouble is we have around 200 students which are registered to Panda, and if you really do not adhere to the standards on handing in, I mean I have a really hard time, and I don't have that amount of time to deal with all the corner cases, and when you do not get the naming convention right and all that, so I really do not have the time to deal with that. So it will be just 0 points, but it shouldn't be too difficult to really hand it in correctly. So questions so far? Haha, funny question, because you cannot really ask questions at this point, but maybe later on in the Panda system you can ask some questions in the forum. Okay, so let's start with now with the real lectures, so to say, with the interesting bits. So history of C++, what can I tell you about that? What is C++? So C++ is quite a big language. So I mean, it's like here, this is the TOB Programming Community Index. And what they do, they record basically in what demand a programming language is, what are the demands for certain programming languages. And how they do it is they search the web. So they look for online courses to certain programming languages, demands in terms of job offers and all that good stuff. And C++ is here in orange, and as you see, it's always one of the big three, big four competitors. So now, 2020, it's like at rank four. More popular are only Java, C, and here you have Python. But then C++ is already on the fourth place. So it seems to be an important language. Which has a great, where there exists a great demand for. So what is C++? You can look up Bjarne's talk from Bjarne Straustrup, which is called The Essence of C++. And there are some bullet points here really to kind of specify what C++ is or should be. Some of them are really kind of a joke, but let's go through them. So what could you say about C++? So it's an object-oriented programming language. Yeah, it can definitely be used in that way. It allows you to perform generic programming. True. It allows for template meter programming. Yeah, that's also true. Buffer overflows. Yeah, security issues. Okay, so C++ is very careful, very powerful. But it does not have too much safety nets like other languages. So if you make some programming mistakes, you can get into real trouble. So like you can cause buffer overflows, which can then be exploited. So be careful. It offers classes. Yeah, you can use classes to model your own data types. Some people might say, what is C++? Yeah, it's too big, because it's really a huge language. It has a tremendous amount of features that you can use or might use. It's also a host for other domain-specific languages. Yeah, also true. So C++ is so powerful that you can, using C++, you can create your own domain-specific languages inside C++. So you can use C++ to craft your own domain-specific languages, which are still C++ code. So yeah, really, really kind of interesting for certain tasks. A hybrid language, whatever that means, as an answer to what is C++. Embedded systems, yeah, C, C++, are the languages of choice when you have to write some code for embedded systems that need a small memory performance footprint. So then you need those languages, I guess. Low level, C++ provides decent abstractions. I mean, it can be used as an object-oriented language, but still you have access to all resources on your machine. So it can also be considered low level because you can manipulate memory addresses and all that kind of stuff. That's a mean point. The next one, a random collection of features. Yeah, if you're a Java programmer, that could be your opinion on C++ probably. So also you have to know that there's always a language war. So like the Java guys against the C++ guys and the other way around. So kind of funny. Also, if your colleagues are Java programmers, so yeah. So class hierarchies, so yeah, it fits right into object-oriented programming. Multi-paradigms, yeah, it supports multiple paradigms, completely true. A failed attempt to build Java, that's really mean. It's C, it's definitely not C. So C++ is its own language. It's compatible to C. So it's backward compatibility is really a huge thing of C++, backwards compatibility to C, but it's really not C, and you should also not implement use C++ as you would use C, really. And too complicated. Depends. I mean, using the modern features of C++, you can also write C++ code in a sane manner, as we will hopefully learn in this course here. So my advice on things to become a professional C++ programmer and developer. So don't be afraid, really. I mean, it seems like a huge language and it has terrifying language features and archaic syntax. But don't be afraid. I mean, learning a new language always takes time and you have all the time. So shouldn't be too much of a problem, I hope. So you need to practice in order to learn this language. So good starting point is do the exercise sheets and do all of them if you can, if you have the time, and even if you already have achieved your 50% of the overall points, please also do the remaining exercise sheets. They really help to get a better understanding, I believe. Read a lot. Books. I gave you a bit of literature, books, C++ forums, as well as code, of course. Reading other people's code might also be helpful, especially if you read code from more advanced programmers. So you might be able to gain some new insights into things, into how to do things in a good, in a sane manner. So please do that. Yeah, do the exercise. I already told you about that. And because of C++, C++'s archaic syntax. Sometimes stuff really looks like magic at first glance, but you should always ask yourself, why does it work? How does it work? And if you're really interested in something, yeah, you are of course free to use Google or whatever resource you would like to look up that thing and to gain an understanding how that works and why that works. And once you gain some new knowledge, you're of course allowed to share your knowledge, and I highly recommend to also discuss with your friends about what you just found out. So, and programming will be really fun when you once you understood it, because you can basically craft your own world in C++. So it's really fun once you get the hang of it. So let's now talk about the history of C++. So why do we have C++? So it all started with a BCPL, which was one of the first programming languages. BCPL stands for Basic Combined Programming Language. So in the early days, computers were programmed by hand. So, I mean, you could buy huge machines for a huge amount of money. I mean, as a private person, you would not be able to afford one of those machines, but huge companies would buy those machines. And they would have one huge mainframe computer, which then can run some programs. And for each computer, they had to write the program specifically for this machines that they just sold. And of course, it's not very scalable. If you imagine computers got cheaper and cheaper, and I mean, ordinary people can now nowadays, of course, buy computers anywhere, and you probably also have a kind of smartphone here. And you cannot just for each computer, for each new architecture, implement your own programs, write your own software that runs on that computer. So one had to craft some kind of language which you can then compile to different target architectures in order to make that process more scalable. And one attempt which failed was BCPL, so basic combined programming language, so a language in order to write some basic utilities that make your computer do things, do useful things. One of the properties of that BCPL language is it has no data types. It just really allows you to access memory, and then whatever is in that memory, you can do whatever you would like. So no data types. And you will learn that data types are a really good thing, because data types prevent you from making errors. So usually you wish to have data types. So after BCPL, there has been the language B. So again, also an attempt to create a language to implement entire operating systems, which then run on a computer, and which could also be ported from one computer to another. But also B failed, because it was not powerful enough to really implement operating systems. And after B, there came the C language, and C is a really famous language. It is used all over the place, and it's still used today. If you recall the Tiobi index I showed you, if I recall correctly, C was on second place on the programming index, Tiobi. So tremendously successful language. So, and C was developed by Brian Kernighan and Dennis Ritchie. You see those guys here in the buff. And after C, because in C is not an object-oriented language, and object orientation came up at some point, and people noticed that if you program in an object-oriented way, you can write really more or less easy to maintain software projects, so a larger software, you can realize them in a good way using object-oriented programming style. And so C did not have classes, which you need to do that object-oriented stuff, which we will learn all about later on. So Bjarne Straustrup really created C with classes. So he took the C language and added more features to it, so to say, added class capabilities. So, and that was basically the birth of C++. So before C++, it was called C with classes, or so an extended C, but then C with classes developed into its own language, so to say, which we now know as C++. And it's, of course, dynamically evolving. So we now have the more modern standards like C++ 11, 14, 17, which are oftentimes called modern C++. And currently, there's also much work going on C++ 20. I mean, we already have 2020, so the standard committee has already standardized the features of C++ 20, but the compiler writers have not implemented all the features yet. So it takes usually a bit of time. And yeah, I would say, personally, I would say that the language got better and better over the last standards, like modern C++. It's a quite useful and modern language that you can, yeah, that's really fun to use. So why are we not learning C++ 20? I mean, has already been standardized. Why are we not learning that advanced stuff, the new stuff? Because, I mean, adaption needs time. I mean, concepts and ideas always first, and it's very easy to come up with some ideas and concepts and all the good stuff. But then, of course, you need some compiler implementations to follow. Otherwise, you have a theoretical concept, but you cannot really use it in practice. So after the concepts and ideas that you elaborated on, then you need a compiler implementation that you can actually use. Then you have void. So nothing happens for a few years. And so there's a saying that the industry usually adapts 5 to 10 years later after it was implemented in several compilers and it has been debugged. So what are the reasons for that late adaptation in many companies of the standard? So reasons are that the concepts have to be proven as useful, because why should I integrate new stuff into my project, into my programming project, if it doesn't do me any good? So it's just a waste of time. So concepts have to be proven useful, otherwise why should I bother using them? And also compilers have to mature over time. So that means a compiler is a piece of software, as we will learn in a second. And also software contains bugs, and also compiler contain bugs. So and compilers have to fix those bugs over time, because probably for your software project that you ship to a customer, you don't wish to ship some buggy software produced by a buggy compiler. So those are some of the reasons for that delay. So we have BCBL, we have B, we have C, we have C++, but why not D after C? I mean, it seems more reasonable to have D. The thing is that C was and is still today tremendously successful. It's used all over the place in embedded systems, high performance computing, and lots and lots of places. And lots of existing code therefore was and is still written in C, and it's still out there running on some machines doing useful stuff. And the idea coming up with C++ rather than D is, do not break compatibility, because people wanted a language that is still compatible with C. That means if you have a C++ compiler, you can also have that C++ compiler operate on C. Basically, a C++ compiler can also compile C code, or most of C code that you can write. So C could be considered as a subset of C++, and vice versa. So C++ is also a superset of C. So do not break compatibility. Be an increment rather than a new language. That's why it has been called C++, so as an increment. But there still exists a language called D, but D is no longer compatible with C. So they broke compatibility at some point, or right at the design, right at the start, so to say. And D is also in use. I know, for instance, that Deutsche Bahn uses the D programming language, because it's kind of nice language. I already used it occasionally, so also good language. But yes, C++ is, of course, the greatest language of them all, so you should learn C++, of course. But be aware that modern C++ is not C and has very little to do with C++. And you should not implement in C++ in a C style, so completely different styles. And I will teach you C++ and not C. So I already mentioned the term compilers quite a lot, I believe, and so let's talk about C++ compilers. What the heck is a compiler? So a compiler is a box or a piece of software. It's basically a program which takes a source program is usually your program text that you enter into a text file, and then you give that text file to that compiler. And the compiler then transforms your source program into a target program. So it's basically some kind of transformation. So a compiler transforms your source program into a target program. And as I said, a source program is usually a text file containing C++ code. And the output is usually a target program. It's usually a binary program. A program in binary form that you can execute on your machine that you compiled for. So, but that also means that you have two steps, right? So you have your program in form of source code, so some text files containing C++ source codes. The compiler translates the source code into some target program, into an executable program, and then you have a second step where you can now run your target program off some input data. So you put some input data usually into your target program. You do some useful processing, compute some meaningful results, whatever that means in your case. And at the very end, you get an answer, so to say, you get some output, usually the solution of your problem that you taught your computer to solve. Yeah, so two steps. When you use a compiled language like C++, you have two steps. You have a compilation step where you create from your source program your binary executable, and then you can run your, in the second step, you can run your binary executable on some input and create some output. So are there any other forms? Yeah, there are also interpreted languages, and for interpreted language, you need an interpreter. One language would be Python. That could be mentioned here because Python is an interpreted language. Interpreted language, you only need one piece of software or one program, which is called the interpreter. It takes your source program, which is again just a text file containing the codes, the code in Python, for instance, in the Python language. And the interpreter not only takes the source program, but also in addition, it also directly takes the input. And the interpreter goes through your source program in the text format usually, interprets each line of your program, and then directly executes it on the given input in one step. So you have no compilation step in between or beforehand. You have line by line, so to say, the interpreter interprets your source code and applies it to the inputs that you give that program. Input can also be empty, of course, but usually you have some inputs in order to produce the output, as you can see here. So that's how an interpreter works. But also that means that an interpreter has to do more work. So that means that interpreted languages or programs that need to be interpreted are usually much slower than a compiled language, because in a compiled language, you have done the compilation step beforehand, and then you already have the binary and you can run it on your machine 100,000 times or whatnot. And it's much faster because an interpreter has to translate your program basically on the fly and then apply those instructions on the given input. So interpreted languages usually much slower in terms of performance. So do we have any other form? Yes, of course, we have even more. We also have hybrid compilers, which are both essentially. So they use compilation techniques and they also interpreting stuff at the same time. So here would be an example. So in hybrid compilers, you have a translator, which takes a given source program, again, usually a text file containing some source code of that programming language of choice. It generates some kind of intermediate program, some intermediate language, which is then shoved into what's called a virtual machine. And the virtual machine is some kind of an interpreter which reads a specific intermediate program and the inputs that your program should process in order to create some output. And an example language that use hybrid compilers as a runtime environment would be Java, of course. Java has its own virtual machine, it's a runtime environment, and in the Java world, exactly this thing here happens, so to say. So you have your Java code, which is translated to Java bytecode, which is then shoved into a virtual machine, and the virtual machine is executing that Java bytecode on some inputs in order to create some outputs. So those are basically the basic concepts here. Okay, C++ compilers. I mean, now we have theory, but also we need some compiler implementations, so some real compilers that we can use on our computers. So I present here two major compilers. One of them is GCC. GCC stands for the GNU Compiler Collections, and it all also includes some front-ends, some compiler front-ends for C and C++. GCC is the standard compiler on most Linux distributions. There's a saying that the most C++ compiler, the most used C++ compiler in the world. So first stable release was already in 1988. It's one huge monolithic design, so it's one huge program essentially. And I mean, at the very beginning, of course, you don't have a C C++ compiler, because at some point you need to write and you need to develop your first C++ compiler. So how can you have a C++ compiler in the first place? GCC is written by what's called bootstrapping. So that means essentially that GCC was implemented, was written by something else until it was powerful enough to compile itself. So you can write your own C++ compiler using C++ by a process called bootstrapping. So if you're interested in how bootstrapping works, just go to Wikipedia and go for bootstrapping. It's quite an interesting technique, really. Then we have the Clang compiler, which I am personally a huge fan of, because I also use it for my PhD project. So Clang is a compiler frontend for the C-like languages, including C and C++ and Objective-C and whatnot. What important for this course here is, of course, the C++ functionalities. And it's really also widely used. It's used by Google, Apple, and Oracle, so all the major companies probably use Clang. It also started as a PhD thesis by a guy called Chris Lettner, so quite a big brain as well, because writing a C++ compiler is a really hard task. And the first stable version was crafted or finished in 2009. And the Clang compiler is built on top of a reusable compiler infrastructure, which is called LLVM. So you don't need to know what that is, but it's part of a compiler infrastructure. A huge C++ project, yeah, and it's written in C++ itself, because prior to Clang, there already have been some C++ compilers, like GCC, so you can implement your own C++ compiler nowadays, written in C++, which you translate which you compile with another C++ compiler, and then you can write your own C++ compiler within C++. Yeah, this is the icon here for the LLVM project. And of course, there are a lot more C++ compiler. Intel has the ICC, the Intel C compiler and C++ compiler. So every major company basically has its own C++ compiler as well. But most importantly are probably GCC and Clang. Okay, now let's open up the compiler box. So on the previous slides, I told you, yeah, we have a compiler and it gets a source program and it transforms it into a target program, and it was just a black box, so some piece of software which does all that thing. So let's open up that box a bit. So GCC and Clang are essentially language processing systems. So it's not just, yeah, take the source code and immediately produce output. Those are language processing systems, which contain or comprise a huge amount of intermediate steps. And I will tell you about those here on the slides. So C++ is usually a compiled language, and C++ compilers are language processing systems and often called compiler toolchains. So here's a better picture, or a more detailed picture, on what a language processing and therefore what a C++ compiler is. So at the beginning, you have your source code, your source program that you also will write in the accompanying exercises here for this course. And first of all, the first step is really a pre-processing step. So the compiler or the language processing system reads your source code and pre-processes it. And then you have some kind of modified source program, which is then shoved into the compiler. And the compiler does not immediately create machine code, but usually the compiler creates assembly code. So the output is really an assembly program. And then there's another program which is called an assembler, and the assembler reads the assembly code and assembles it to the machine that you target. And it creates machine code that the machine understands and then can execute. And then you have another part of the language processing system, which is called the linker or loader. So after you transformed your source program into machine code, then You need a linker which may needs to add links to libraries that you're using. Maybe if you write some code which uses an external library, the linker has to make links between those pieces of code, between your code and the library codes. And then eventually you have a complete program, a large binary, and this can be executed by your machine, by your computer, and then you have your final target machine code. All right. Okay. So remark on what follows. Quick remark. Keep simple things simple, as simple as possible, but not simpler. Yeah, famous quote by Albert Einstein. Why? Why should we do that? Why do we need to do that? The problem is really if you need to start learning a new programming language. The question is always, where can we start? Because programming and learning a new programming language, it all looks like magic. And that's a huge problem. And you cannot start anywhere if you do not take certain things for granted. So at the very beginning, I will tell you some stuff. And you just have to believe me that it has to be done that way, that it works that way. And over time, we will learn why that is. If we would not do that, we are not able to start learning a language, a programming language, because it, at the beginning, as said, it all looks like magic. So we have to start somewhere, and then we make our way from there. That's here, the basic idea. So now let's write our first program. So, and the first program is usually, for computer scientists at least, a Hello World program. It's just a tiny program which prints Hello World to the command line. And usually those are very simple, but I mean, you can still explain a lot of language features and syntax on those small Hello World programs. So let's have a Hello World program. But before we have a Hello World program, let's have the shortest valid C++ program. So the shortest C++ program is this one here, or you can be even shorter if you use this one here. So what do we have here? Oh boy, let's have a look. So here, main. Main is a function. Main is a function. And main is a very special function because when you translate your program, which would be just this line of code here, if you translate it into machine code using the compiler compiles your source into a binary program, then the main function is the first function that's executed if you run your program. So it's basically, the main function is the program's entry point. The main function has a parameter list here, which is empty in that case. So the parentheses are a parameter list. You can give a function some parameters, but here we don't use anything. You have some braces, some curly braces, which are empty. So that means the program doesn't do anything, because in between those curly braces, you would usually write some code that does some meaningful stuff, some stuff that's useful to you. And here, the main function also has a return value. So integer is a data type, and it's a return value. That means that the main function at the very end returns a value. And this value is returned to the operating system, and then the operating system can check the state of your program. So once your program has finished, it has accomplished its job, it needs to return a value from main. And if you return a zero, like in the program above, that basically means to the operating system, yeah, everything worked fine, everything worked well. And if you return a value other than zero, that means that your program had some problems, basically to indicate the success of your program to the operating system. And if you don't write that return here, it's going to be added automatically by the compiler. So, shortest C++ program, let's now write a Hello World program. So this would be a program that prints Hello World to the command line if you execute the program. So what do we have here? The Hello World program uses something which is called a header file. So, and the header file here is IOStream. And here, this one is an include directive. So basically, we wish to use whatever is in that include file here, really. Then we have our main function again, similar to the above. This time, the main function has some arguments. I told you that functions can also have arguments. In this case, we have some arguments to that function. And here in that line, we are printing hello world to the command line, really. So maybe let's go through the program line by line. So sorry, we also have a comment here. So this backslash indicate a comment line. So comments, code comments are completely ignored by the compiler. So what's the use of commenting your program? So programs can be quite complex, quite difficult to understand. And by using comments, you can remind yourself on what certain pieces of your program do. So if you write a program, a complex program, and then you go on vacation for 1 or 2 weeks, and then you have to start working on your program again, then it might be that you do not understand yourself what the program does anymore. And for this is the reason why we have code comments. So code comments remind you what your code does. And also it helps your coworkers. So usually if you need to implement a larger software project, you're not the only developer who works on that project. And maybe you write some codes and maybe one of your colleagues wish to use some of your codes, and he can then also have a look at the code comments. So that's the purpose of comments basically. So yeah, we have a main function in this case here with arguments, so the program's entry point. The program, the Hello World program here, also uses a namespace. This std is called a namespace. We have the scope operator, which is this colon colon here. We have a shift operator, which is this smaller than, so this shift operator. It uses a string literal, so this in parentheses, in quotation marks here, it's called a string literal, so it's a piece of text essentially. And we also make use of a variable called cout. So cout is a standard output stream. So you could have some data, and using the shift left operator, you can shove that data over into the output stream, cout, which lives in the namespace standard. And then after we wrote that piece of data, hello world, the text hello world, after we moved that to the output stream, so to say, and printed it to the command line, our program is done. And it then returns the return value 0 to the operating system to indicate, oh, everything worked fine. I'm done here. So, and the return 0 is a value for the operating system, and 0 indicates success, and if you have values other than 0, indicate failure. So if you return -1, your operating system knows that something went wrong here by executing your program. All right. Yeah, I know that's a bit of tough. That's tough, but how does it work? Now I have some program code here, some hello world. What do I do with that? So what you would do is you would now go on and edit a text file. So create a new text file, give it some name like hello.cpp, and now type the following contents into the text file, namely this piece of code here. Type that into the text file. And now you can tell your compiler, which is installed on your computer, hopefully. At least it's installed on the virtual machine that I provide to you. So you can now, or you must now, tell your compiler how to translate this file here with the following contents into an executable machine code. And how do you do that? The command for that is cc, then cc is the compiler, essentially. Then you give it as a parameter the source code, and your program currently consists of only one file, which goes by the name of hello.cpp, and you use the parameter here dash o for output. Here now you specify the output, and you tell the compiler that the binary file, that it should produce a binary file, and the binary file should be called hello, so dash o for output. So, and once your compiler successfully compiled your program, and the compiler will tell you if it could not successfully compile your program, but if it could successfully compile your program, then you are left with a file that is called hello. It's your executable binary, and you can execute it with a dot slash hello, and then the computer will run your hello program. And hopefully it will print hello world to the command line. And instead of C, please use G++, which is G++ is the C++ compiler of the GCC GNU compiler collection. Or if you wish to use Clang, you can also use Clang. Doesn't really matter for this course. You can also use Clang by using Clang++ instead of CC. So Clang++ hello.cpp dash o hello would be the command to compile your program. Some useful compiler flags, so those switches like dash o are called compiler flags and can be used to interact with your compiler in some way. So there are some other useful compiler flags that you should probably be using. So one compiler flag is the dash w all for all warnings. So the compiler can issue warnings if the compiler sees some dubious language constructs or some syntax error. So the mean thing about programming is you have to adhere to the language's syntax. So if you would just leave out this semicolon after return zero, your program would not be valid anymore. So your program would be rubbish, so to say. But if you turn on the compiler warnings, the compiler will tell you about errors and warnings in your program text. And then you can go on and fix those errors and warnings. So please, if you are a beginner, and you probably are, please always turn on all warnings that your compiler has, because if the compiler is able to find a warning or to issue a warning, then there's usually something wrong with your program. You can also, if you like the pain, you can also enable more warnings by using dash w extra, so for extra warnings. And I would also recommend to turn on those extra warnings as well, especially as a beginner. And also, I mean, always, you should always, there's no reason why you should not turn on those warnings. There's a dash lowercase g for insert debugging symbols that will be relevant later on, so we can ignore it for now. Your compiler is, I mean, most C++ compilers are called optimizing compilers because they can optimize your source code. What does it mean? That means if you write a piece of code, the compiler reads your program and transforms it into machine code. But in between, the compiler is allowed to optimize your program to make it run faster on the given machine. And you can also tell your compiler, hey, compiler, please optimize my program, which you can do using the following flag, dash uppercase O, and then you have X, and X is a number, 0 to 3. 0 meaning compiler do not perform any optimization, and 3 is do everything you can to make that program run faster. And we will later on in the later lectures have a special lecture dedicated to performance optimizations, because C++ is a language which is mostly used if you need to write performance critical programs, which should run as fast as possible, and therefore you need those compiler optimizations. You already saw that dash lowercase o, so specifying the output file that you can also use, and then of course dash lowercase std, This can be used to specify the C++ standard. So you should specify one of the following standards, C++ 11, 14, or 17, on the compilers installed on the virtual machine image, on the virtual machine, all support C++ 17. So you should always specify the C++ standard to be C++ 17, telling the compiler, yeah, please use that language standard. Because if you don't do that, it might be that you are not allowed to use certain language features, because maybe some language features have been introduced in C++ 11, 14, or 17. And if you did not specify the standard to be 17, then the compiler usually does not allow to use some language constructs and features introduced in 17. So please always turn on the standard to 17, to the most recent standard. So an example command line which you could craft would be here G++. Let's use the GC compiler. G++ dash all warnings, extra warnings, specifying the standard to be C++ 17. Here we specify our file which contains this piece of code here. And then we specify the output file. So the output file should be called hello. So that is the compiler creates a binary which goes by the name of hello, which you can then execute by using dot slash and then the hello name. And this is all in one go and one compiler call and one compiler invocation here, really. But remember that a C++ compiler is basically just a language processing system. So it usually consists multiple steps. The compiler is GCC or Clang are just used as a shell. So the compiler, the GCC, G++ or Clang++ program do all the right steps in the right order. But if you're really interested in how those language processing systems work, you can also ask the compiler to generate the intermediate steps here. So you can really ask the compiler, hey compiler, please only pre-process my source code and then show it to me, and do not do the other steps involved in the language processing system. Also, you can ask your compiler, hey compiler, please generate the assembly program and do nothing else. So just show me the assembly program that corresponds to my source program here. So for instance, here the hashtag directives here, those are not instructions for the compiler, but those green instructions here, those preprocessor directives starting with the hashtag here, those are instructions for the preprocessor. That's not the compiler here, the preprocessor. And then the preprocessor runs first of your program. It transforms all those preprocessor directives, and then you are left with a modified version of your source program, and then and only then the compiler starts its work. And the include directives just perform textual insertion. So somewhere on your computer is a file which goes by the name of IOStream, and the preprocessor now does the following. You tell the preprocessor, hey, please include that stuff here. And so there is a file on your computer which goes by the name of IOStream, and the preprocessor just takes the contents of that IOStream file and copies it into your program here, which is shown here. So, and then you would obtain your modified source code, your modified source program. And within the IOStream file, there are also some variables defined, like this cout variable. It is defined in that file here. It comes from that file. Then we have std colon colon, which is a namespace. So what are namespaces? Can't we just use cout as some kind of variable, and then we can do certain stuff with that variable? Yes, we could, in fact, but namespaces serve the following purpose. Namespaces can hold code. So you can write some code that you put into a namespace. And if you then wish to use that code, you have to prefix that piece of stuff that you that you implemented within your code, like here's the cout variable, you have to prefix it with the corresponding respective namespace, in this case std standard std colon colon. And why do we need that? When you use namespaces, it helps you to avoid collisions. For instance, variable names, function names, it's all about names. Because imagine you write a piece of program and your program, for instance, creates a variable x. So far, so good. But now you're using a library because you wish to accomplish some stuff, and for that task you wish to use a library. And now imagine this library also uses a variable by the name of x. Then the compiler would not know, I have now two variables by the name of x. What x should I use? So the compiler cannot really make random decisions. The compiler will just throw an error at you and will tell you, yeah, there's multiple definitions of x. This does not work. Please fix it. And in order to avoid such name collisions here, you can put your code in namespaces, which is why almost every library that you use that is meant to be used by other people, they wrap their code in a namespace that you must then specify. And then you could have multiple variables by the same name. For instance, you could here have the standard cout variable, and you can also now go on in your program and define your own cout variable, and it wouldn't be a problem, because you can distinguish between those variables' names. You have your own cout variable, and then you have the prefix cout variable, and those are completely different things for the compiler. But because we are using at the very beginning, we will, and also at the end, all the time, we are using the STL, and we will use the we will use code from the standard template library so frequently that we do not really wish to write std colon colon all the time if we wish to use some stuff from the STL. So and in order to, you can avoid that, writing std all the time, by writing the following in your program. So you can have the command for the compiler, basically. So using namespace std, and if you write that in your program, then you can use the cout variable without the prefix std. Basically, you're telling the compiler, yeah, I wish to use everything that lives in the namespace std. That's basically what the line means. So, and here's an example. So we use using namespace std, and then we can use cout without any problems, without the prefixing. So the compiler has also an option. Here we now are in the assembly, so let's create assembly. So the compiler has an option dash uppercase S, which allows you to have a look at the assembly code of your program if you are interested and ever need that, but just for completeness here. So again, CC is G++ or Clang++, please replace with ever you like. So you specify your source code, then you use this compiler switch here, and then you tell the compiler, yeah, please output the assembly in a file which is called hello.as for assembly. And the contents of that file will look like follows. It's just a bit of assembly code here. So, and it continues and goes on. And those are really instructions for the machine. Those are very primitive instructions for the machine, assembly code. And this would be assembled by the program is called the assembler, which now takes this assembly code and matches it to the respective machine instruction. Okay, you can, and this is what we're using most of the time, probably. We can also compile to a binary file directly. If you just call the compiler with the source files, and we just specify an output file, which is the name of the binary, and then we just have a plain binary. And the content of that binary file can be, for instance, opened with a hex editor. So, and it's just ones and zeros, really. And you can execute that file, but that file is not meant to be read by humans. So just really binary. All right, so let's now go to the next chapter, so to say, setting up a development environment. I showed you how to call the compiler by hand, but calling the compiler by hand is kind of wasteful, especially if you have larger projects which consists of multiple files, then you do not really wish to type GCC or G++ and then file name and then another file and then another file and then link it all together. That's kind of wasteful. And so there are several clever mechanisms that you can use as kind of shortcuts. One shortcut, for instance, is using a make file. So what is a make file? A make file is again also a text file in which you can type some rules, and those rules describe how to invoke your compiler. And then there's a corresponding program. So there's a program called make, all lower cases. And this make program processes make files. It reads and identifies the rules that you just encoded into the make file. And make file is really a text file by the name of make file. And also it starts with an uppercase M. That's quite important. And so the make program reads your rules from the make file and it executes them on demand as you need them. And it's a really flexible and powerful mechanism, which you can use to accomplish a bunch of things. Usually you have one makefile per project. If you have a smaller project, if you have a larger project, then probably also have a few more makefiles, which are responsible for different things. But writing makefiles is a bit difficult for complex tasks. If you wish to encode complex tasks, then it can be a bit difficult. But on the other hand, you see what's going on and nothing is hidden under the carpet. So yeah, that's basically make files. On the other hand, you can of course use IDEs, so integrated development environments, or fully fledged IDEs. And those IDEs usually handle the project for you. And also all the source code and source files that belong to your project. It also handles the compiler invocation. So usually if you have a fully fledged IDE, you can in graphical windows, you can type here a new file and then it create a file by name XYZ. Yeah, then you can type your contents, enter your contents, edit that this file. And then usually there's somewhere some play button where you just click and the IDE will compile that file for you in a completely automated manner, and it will run the program eventually. It's of course much easier to use than writing your make files. It will also, if you use an IDE, clever IDE, it will also find syntax errors on the fly. But for more complex tasks, it can be really painful because your lack of control. So in makefile, you can do whatever you wish to write. In IDEs, you have to do a huge amount of clicks and find the right menus to configure your project. So sometimes you feel your lack of control. So it hides complexity, which can also be a good thing, but as a beginner, for instance. But as a professional, yeah, sometimes it's just a pain. So I myself use often a combination of both. So usually I have some make or CMake files, and I have a small editor which I use to edit my files. And I will show you later on how I do it. You can use whatever feels best to you. So I really do not care how you edit your source files. Let's have some example on make files. Again, using the compiler by hand is fiddly, so maybe let's try make. So what you would do is you would really have a file which goes by the name of make file, and you would put some executable target rules into that make file. It's processed by make. Again, easy to use, hard to write. There are even books on make and how to write good make files and all that stuff. But usually how it works in practice is nobody writes their own make file. you just copy an existing Makefile from some of your colleagues or some other project, and then go from there and just do some minor tweaks and modifications. So if you wish to do, if you wish to use Makefiles and do not use the compiler by hand, invoking the compiler by hand, I have prepared some Makefiles for you, which you can find on the virtual machine in the programs directory. There you have some example Makefiles that you can just use, and they should just work out of the box. And then you can do some minor tweaks if you are interested, but other than that, just ready to use. So how it would work is you would create a directory for your project. So have a directory for your project, which you, for instance, could call my cool project. And then in that project, you create a file called makefile. You can copy the following contents, or you can edit the following contents into that makefile. And then you create another file, which goes by the name of hello.cpp. And this file has the following contents here. And you save both files. And then in that directory, you call the make command, so make. And then make reads here the instructions of the makefile, and it will compile your program. So let's quickly go through this makefile here. So you have a few variables. So you have a variable for your program name, hello underscore world. You have a variable for your C compiler, or C++ compiler, which here in this case would be set to G++. You can also specify some compiler flags. And here in red, those are the rules. So you have a rule all, and you have a rule clean. And the rule all basically calls your compiler. Remember, that's a variable name, so it's basically G++, std equal to C++14, and all warnings. And then just all CPP files within this directory should be compiled into a single binary program by the name of procname, which is hello underscore world. So if you call make, then you would compile it in a completely automated manner, because then make would take care of your compilation. So might wish to use that, but it's you don't have to, of course. You can also use integrated development environments. Eclipse also has a version for C and C++. It would be a full IDE, which is available for Windows, Linux, or Mac. So you can also install Eclipse on the virtual machine, because there also exists a version for Linux. So here's a small picture of the respective website. You can also use Visual Studio Code. That's the editor I'm using. It's a compact editor, which actually is quite nice to use. I will show it to you at the very end of the lecture. And there's also a version for Windows, Linux, or Mac. So all major operating systems are supported. Here is its web page. I do not wish to impose any restrictions on you. Do whatever feels good and right for you, depending on your programming level and experience, I guess. So, setting up a development environment. I will provide a virtual machine, or I already provided you a virtual machine, which you can now download. The password for the virtual machine is cppp, quite a secret password, I guess, and it's in Ubuntu, so it's a Linux. It's zipped, or it's compressed at least, and if you uncompress it because you wish to run that virtual machine using VirtualBox, for instance, it's around 20 gigabytes, so make sure that you have sufficient space on whatever operating system you are running. And the great thing is that the virtual machine is set up in a way that it ships with everything that is needed, so no configuration required from your side. You can just go on edit files and call C and C++ compilers, because GCC and the Clang compiler are already installed on that machine. And also Visual Studio Code is also installed on that machine, so you have a nice environment and do not need to install anything on your own. Why did I provide this virtual machine? because if you have around 200 students and I cannot answer all the questions, if you have a Windows machine, for instance, and you wish to use your Windows machine to develop C++ software, please do not expect me to fix all your problems because you cannot really get a C++ compiler running on Windows. I could do it for one student, but if we have around 200 students and each and everyone has some problems, difficulties to set up things, I mean, I really do not have the time to do that. That's the reason why I provide a virtual machine for you, which you can use. Everything is set up and ready to go. So if you have trouble to use your ordinary daily operating system, please just use the virtual machine. And so we don't wasting our time fixing errors and stuff. All right, that being said, a remark on compiler errors. If you have the following program here, Hello World program again, at the first glance, it looks perfectly fine, right? But the compiler thinks otherwise. So if you compile that program with Clang, then we get the following error message, so error. Use of undeclared identifier cout. Did you mean stut ? Cout at this point in time, here at this place? That would be the warning that Clang issues. And if you use G++ or GCC's C++ compiler, it will also tell you cout was not declared in the scope. Suggested alternative, stut cout. So, and oh, we forgot something here, really. So we forgot the prefix std::. We forgot to add the prefix to cout. Or we could also use cout as is, but then we would need to have the using namespace std:, command here within the program. And those errors will be quite common, or you will forget a semicolon. Those are ordinary and default errors, so those errors are the default case, and you will make a lot of errors, I guess, when you are start learning C++ or any new programming language. But then luckily the compiler tells you about those errors. So, and please don't panic and just scream, ah, my code doesn't compile, I cannot do anything. I mean, please read the error messages, and usually the compiler gives you very good hints on what's wrong with your program. And if your program contains such errors, the compiler is not able to compile it down to a binary, an executable binary. So you need to fix those errors. Otherwise, the compiler can't help you really. And read those error messages carefully. You are, of course, allowed to use Google. So if you have an error message and you cannot make sense of that error message on your own, just copy and paste the error message to Google. And usually you have the first three hits are already solving a problem, I guess. And there are also some programming forums like Stack Overflow where you can ask questions and they will help. You can also paste questions into Panda, and then I will tell you what that compiler error message mean, or other students, your colleagues can also tell you if they already figured out. But please do not post solutions to the Panda system, right, to the Panda forum. That should be clear, I guess. Okay, last point of today's lecture, so basic terms and concepts. So we need some data types. So I told you that BCPL was a language, one of the first languages to implement operating systems. But this language had an issue because it did not have data types. And you will learn why data types are a good thing, a useful thing, because, I mean, they prevent you from making errors. So, I mean, at the very end, it's all ones and zeros. The data is all stored as ones and zeros. But you can, of course, interpret those ones and zeros in different ways. And so data types help you to structure your data. They provide meaning to a data. So maybe you have a bit string of 8 bits, and you have a certain bit pattern stored into those 8 bits, or 8 bits are also a byte, of course. And the data type then specifies the meaning. What does that specific bit string mean in corresponding context? So we have some data types, of course, in C++, which help you to structure your data and to give meaning to bit strings. So you have a Boolean type. So Boolean type name would be bool. So yes, and a bool can be true or false. So you can store two values within a bool data type, so true and false. And all those blue highlighted things, all those words here highlighted in blue, are keywords of the C++ language. So keywords are most of the time highlighted in blue. So a bool shouldn't be too interesting. So then we also have character types. So a character type can store characters, individual characters. So uppercase A you could store in such a character data type. You have some integers, integer types. So an int specifies an integer type and you can store a value, for instance, an integer value in that data type, in a variable of that type, for instance, 42. You could fit into that data type. And please also observe that those data types have certain ranges. All of those data types have a certain number of bits you can use. And that also means that the values that you can write into the data type, that you can store in such a data type, are restricted. Yeah? So please keep that in mind. For instance, a bool can hold two values, true or false. If you have a character, character is 8 bits, so 1 byte. And if you have a signed character, you can store like, using 2's complement, minus 128 to 127 as concrete integer values in that character. Or if you have an unsigned character, you can store 0 to 255. So please be aware that you can only store certain values in certain data types. That's the main message here. What numbers here, what exact values you can store in them is not that very relevant here. You can look it up anytime, but please be aware that you can only store a limited amount of values in certain data types. Then you also have some integer modifiers, which also modify the sizes. So for integer types, you can specify if the type should be should store signed or unsigned values. And you can also modify the sizes by using the keywords short, long, or long, long. Again, we will have examples to all those use cases later on, but just for completeness. And you, of course, can also store real numbers. So there are certain floating point types which allow you to store real numbers, like float, double, long double. And by default, you should always use double, because nowadays our computers or machines have enough memory. So float is really not that precise, so you should always stick to double as a default, double precision. And also recall that those data types only have a limited number of bits that they use for storing values. So that means that you cannot store, especially you cannot store floating point numbers or real numbers in arbitrary precision. That simply does not work. So especially those floating point numbers are just approximations, so to say, of reality and real numbers from mathematics. So just approximations. Let's have a look at integer encoding. I told you that we have in our computer memory, we have some bit strings, which have multiple meanings depending on what data type they should be associated with. So let's have an example. Let's have an unsigned character data type. Character is 1 byte or 8 bit, and we told it to be unsigned. and if you use unsigned, then we have a dual number encoding. If you use unsigned, then whatever is the value of that is stored in that data type or using the data type, it's interpreted with the dual number encoding. That means if I have this bit string here, I need and I now wish to figure out what decimal value is stored in here, I can compute the decimal value. I mean, in our dual system, we only have ones and zeros, so it's like powers of two. And if we wish to compute the value here in our decimal system, we can just apply the following algorithm. So those bits denote the factors of different powers of two. So here we have a one at the most right place. So 1 times 2 to the 0, plus 1 times 2 to the 1, plus 0 times 2 to the 2, and so on, until we reach the leftmost bit, which is a 1, so 1 times 2 to the power of 7. Then we can type that into our calculators, and we have 128 plus 32 plus 16 plus 2 plus 1. Which at the very end gives you 179. That means this bit string here represents the decimal number one or the decimal value 179. So you can do your computation. Assuming you wish to interpret this bit string here as an unsigned character. Now let's have another example. Let's have a signed character data type. Or if you do not use the keyword signed in front of your character, in front of your plain data type, it's always signed. So if you have a character without specifying unsigned, signed, unsigned, it's always signed by default. And also, a character again has 1 byte, so 8 bits. And if you have a signed character or default character, then the 2's complement encoding is used. Let's have an example. How does 2's complement work? The highest bit, so the leftmost bit, the bit with the highest number, the highest power of 2, is encodes the sign. So, because this sign bit here is 1, that means that it's a negative number. And the other bits encode the value, so the remaining bits encode the value. So here the sign bit is 1, negative number, and what from the rest, from the remainder, we have to take 2's complement now in order to compute its value. That means we have to negate all bits, so 1 becomes 0, and 0 would become 1, and then add 1 to the resulting value. So let's have an example. So if you would flip all the bits, 0 becomes 1, 1 becomes 0, 1 becomes 0, 0 becomes 1, and so on, and so on. And then in the second step, we add a 1. So here to this number, we add a 1, and here we just have the 1 added. And then we can take the complement, add 1, yeah, that's what we just did. And then we can compute its decimal value by using the same algorithm, essentially, or the same method as we did for the unsigned character. And then we obtain the value 77. And because we know the leftmost bit, the highest bit was a 1, we know it's a negative number, so it's negative 77. So this is just another example to show you how you associate meaning to a bit string. And you also can play the same game for floating point numbers. Here is a formula which you could use for a float. Here is the formula which you could use for a double data type. But you can do it at home. You can look it up. It's not very interesting. Just for completeness here, I mentioned that of course all those other values are stored with similar encodings. Remark on doubles or floating point numbers: use double as a default data type to encode real numbers because a float is usually far too imprecise for modern computations. And also recall that floating point numbers are not distributed equidistant. That means you have quite good precision using those floating point data types for small numbers around zero. What is your value that you wish to store in those data types? Get bigger in a negative way or in positive, get bigger and bigger. You have far more distance between two different real numbers. Yeah? So the floating point data types are only really an approximation of mathematics, what that's best we can do with the finite memory of our computers, with our machines. Let's talk about comments. We already talked about comments a few slides ago. So why should you bother writing comments? I mean, if you write some code, I mean, first of all, it might be that your compiler doesn't even understand what you mean, and it will give you crazy error messages, and then you have to figure out what's wrong and you have to fix them. And comments should, of course, help yourself and should remind yourself what your code should do, is supposed to do. And also later on, if you develop software in larger teams, it also tells your colleagues what your code should do. So comments tell other people what your code does, and also yourself. Code can be hard to understand. I mean, in most of the time you write simple code, but sometimes if you have a really difficult problem, you need, usually you also need a difficult algorithm to solve the difficult problem, and then it gets kind of tricky to understand. If you encode it into C++, then it's difficult to understand what the code exactly does. So that's why you could use comments to help with that. You can have a single line comment, which is introduced by //. And then the remainder of that line till the line break is, till the new line, is basically a comment line, which is completely ignored by the compiler. You can also have a multi-line comment by using /*. Then you can have also line breaks in your comments if you wish to have some larger comment texts in your program. And then at the very end, you close your comment by using */. It denotes then your comment ends here. And then the next line would be again interpreted, or not interpreted, sorry, would be recognized by your compiler. Personally, I would just use the single line comments. Most editors have also the feature that you can highlight multiple lines and then do a special key combination, and then all lines are prefixed with the //. So you comment a certain amount of code. You comment a certain amount of code out of your compiler seeing it, so to say. Because the problem with those multi-line comments is, what you could also do is you could accidentally have /*, then a comment, then by accident another */, but then you wish to continue with your comment, and then you end your comment again, but the compiler will only recognize what's in between /*, and */ as a comment, and all the remainder stuff is just gibberish to the compiler, and it will complain to you, and it will give you some error messages, and then you need to fix your code. So less error prone is probably using the single line comments if you need to write comments. Okay, let's continue. Integer literals in C++. I mean, you need values in order to specify computations. We already discussed data types, but you also need some concrete values which you associate with those data types in order to specify meaningful computations using C++. And of course, you can have integer literals. And here I have some examples of integer literals in C++. So if you type 100 in your program text, it's an integer literal, so it's an integer number. And as default, it's of data type integer. So the int data type is chosen by default by the compiler. And by default, you're using the decimal system, because, I mean, we are humans, we have 10 fingers, 10 fingers. So by default, we're using the decimal system for convenience. But the compiler internally then makes bit strings out of them and all the good stuff, as I just showed you on the last few slides. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 again is an integer decimal. So and also you should stick to int as the default data type for integers, unless you have good reason to do otherwise. You have 5L, that's an uppercase L, and this would be an integer literal by the value 5 and the data type here. You already told the compiler what data type it should be because it's not a default integer. The L specifying it being a long data type. So it's an integer literal and should be considered as a long or interpreted as a long data type wise, so to say. 1, 2, 3, U is an unsigned integer in decimal. You can also combine those suffixes. So UL is an unsigned long. And I guess by now you got the game. So you can also have a minus, a negative number. O0, which is essentially just 2, because you can have an unlimited amount of zeros that are in front of your number, so just ignored by the compiler, so you have a 2. But this is not the last digit here. It's not a 0, it's an O. And you can also tell your compiler to interpret your literals as in a different number encoding. So that would be an integer minus 2, but it's not in decimal system, but it's in the octal system. So it's really rarely used, but I mean, you can still write such stuff. If you have an integer literal which goes by the value 1FFF and you prefix that integer literal with OX or 0X, this is a real zero digit here, then this would be a hexadecimal number. Sometimes it's quite useful. And here also you have an integer and hexadecimal, and it's an unsigned long data type is used to store that thing. All right, so let's continue. Character literals, A, uppercase A. Star is star, and I mean you use the single quotation marks here basically to indicate characters, which you then can store in a character type. End of string, we have some special characters, and those special characters need to be escaped with a backslash here. So backslash n would be a single character which represents the line breaks, the new line. But obviously you cannot just use n because n is already just the character n. So a new line, so special characters are escaped with a backslash. Backslash t, tab. Backslash apostrophe is apostrophe. Backslash is the backslash character. So all these special characters need to be escaped. And you can also have strings in C++. More on strings later, but string literals I'll show you. So this would be a string literal. If you use the ordinary quotation marks, so double quotation marks, that would be considered as a string literal. We already used it in Hello World. And in Hello World, we also use the backslash n to print a new line to the command line. Yes, strings are a bit special. We will learn why that is later on. Let's continue with the floating point literals in C++. So minus 9.876, that would be a double. Again, by default, you should use a double. And if you use a floating point literal, the compiler will also interpret it as a double. And add the semantics of double to it, unless you tell otherwise using those suffixes similar to the integers. Here we have 123.456, and this e means the exponent, so times 10 to the minus 7, just the double. Here we have 1, you can also use a lowercase e, it basically means just 1 times 10 to the 12. To the power of 12, also a double. You can also have 0.001, also double, just an ordinary real number, floating point number. If you use the suffix f, that tells your compiler to interpret it, to use it as a float. That's also possible, but again, you shouldn't really use floats unless you have good reason. You can use uppercase L to denote a long double. Yeah, and those are basically literals, so values. Values that are interpreted according to a certain data type. And you need, of course, values to specify computations. And also, plain values are not very interesting. What you also need to specify computations and useful algorithms is you need variables. So, and let's have some examples how to define variables in C++. So, imagine you have this piece of program here, so a stub for the main function, and then whatever shows up on the left-hand side in a second, you could just stick into the main function and then compile and execute your program. So, variables have a type. We already talked about the basic primitive types. Variables also have a name, so you can give each variable a name that provides some meaning to you. I mean, the compiler doesn't care about variables' names, but variables' names are important for you as a programmer, as a software developer. And optionally, you can have an initial value and assign an initial value to a variable. Let's have an example. You can specify an integer variable by the name of I, and its initial value should be or is 42. And then you end this by a semicolon. And this is basically a variable definition. Here in the second line, basically, you tell the compiler here, compiler, I would like to have a variable j of type integer, and I do not provide an initial value. We will learn in a second what that means if you do not provide an initial value. You can also specify multiple integers using the comma operator. So I would like, please compiler, I would like to have or to introduce to my program some variables k, l, and m. And k should be initialized to 10, l should be initialized to 42, and m should have no initial value. And you can, of course, do the same thing with doubles, floats, characters, and also string literals. And again, string literals are a bit special in C and C++. That's just because the compatibility with C and C is a really old language. And this is why you have, if you wish to use a string literal, you have to use the special syntax about we will learn later on, so I won't go into detail on why that works. Just believe me that it works for now. We will learn later on why that is. You can also store not only characters, but just a minus 10 integer into the variable x of type character. Again, character is just one byte, so and minus 10 fits into one byte, so that works as well. So you can also have an unsigned integer UI for unsigned integer and assign the value 123 to that variable. What you should not do is as stupid does. So please don't be stupid if avoidable. You should not declare an unsigned int to which you assign a negative value. That's no good. That's not good for you. Because remember that this would be, in fact, this would be interpreted using the 2's complement encoding, where the first bit is a 1 if your number is negative. So here, the first bit is a 1. Indicating it's a negative number, and then the rest is just the lower bits are 1 partially to then encode the 13 basically. But now have this bit string here and shove it into an unsigned int, and in an unsigned int you have the full bit string, which is just interpreted into a dual encoding. That means the highest bit is not the sign, but it's just an ordinary power of 2. So storing minus 13 into an unsigned int is just a huge number. It is not a negative number then anymore, but it's just a huge value which you store there. And it's something completely different than what you intended. So please be aware of that. And also initialize your variables unless you know what you're doing. Because we will come to that in a second. So in languages like Java, Java is a hosted language running on a virtual machine, basically. And if you make a mistake in Java, a programming mistake in Java, like for instance writing a negative number to an unsigned integer, Java, first of all, doesn't allow unsigned integers, and Java is quite nice to the developer. It gives you detailed error messages if you do any errors. C++ is a bit different. If you write some stupid code, then your compiler will just run haywire, and maybe it even produces an executable binary. But if you run that binary file, it will just segfault is the name. That means your program completely crashes. And you usually you do not have any clue why that is. So that's one of the properties of C++. So please don't do that. It's dangerous. Again, it's an integer overflow here that happens. And those kind of things, I mean, C++ is famous for its undefined behavior. That means in some situations, C++ does not specify what should happen in a strange situation. So what that means is the standard allows some situations in which the behavior is not specified in the standard. So that means if the compiler observes a situation which is actually forbidden, or you shouldn't write, which is forbidden, it can do anything. Its behavior is undefined. So here's a nice example. For instance, int I, and then you have an int j, and in j you wish to store the result of I plus 42. But here you notice that I has no initial value. That means I could contain any value. And this would be undefined behavior, meaning that at this point anything can happen. So it really depends on your compiler's implementation. Why would one ever integrate such a strange thing like undefined behavior in a programming language? Why would one ever do that? Why don't we stick to Java, and Java tells us what we did wrong and doesn't allow those kinds of undefined behavior? As said earlier, C++ compilers are optimizing compilers, and the intention is to create the fastest machine code possible. And by allowing undefined behavior, it allows your compilers to produce faster machine codes, oftentimes, because the compilers can assume that certain things cannot happen. And under those exemptions, that bad things are not in the program, then the compiler is able to produce fast machine code at the cost of having such segfaults, which are oftentimes a pain to debug, really. You can also have the auto. You can also make use of the auto keyword if you declare variables. Auto is used for automatic type deduction. So the compiler, you tell the compiler, hey, compiler, please find the correct type. I do not wish to specify the type myself. You can use type ID to check if you're unsure. Just look it up on the internet how it works. It's not very important for now. But my recommendation is you can use auto oftentimes, but my recommendation is always be verbose. Until the type name gets too long or too painful to write, or the type is obvious, then you can use auto. Otherwise, stick to the type you desire, really, so you wish to use. Here's some code, some more complex C++ code in 98 style, where auto did not exist, and also the for loops. The for loop looks a bit terrifying, but because of the modern C++ standards, you can write the same code in a much more in a much nicer looking way. This is essentially the same code, or this code does the same thing, but here you have a much nicer looking code, and also here we can use auto, and here we can use an initializer list. We will learn about all those concepts, but the point is here really that the New features of modern C++ simplify the language in a tremendous manner. Okay, and yeah, that should be more than enough for now here. So you could also play a game now here. What type is X? I mean, if you use auto X, if you declare your variable of auto, so the compiler should find out the type, and you initialize it with a value of 13 integer, and it should be interpreted to long, then X is of type long, of course. And in this case, X would be of type double. Yeah, so just automatic type deduction, quite useful from time to time. Making a point with all those types and integers and auto keywords and initializing integers, and also making a point on, yeah, C++ is quite complex, and C++ is a very old language, which is why there are around 50 ways to initialize a simple integer. And this is no joke. So int, you can create a variable a, type integer, and initialize it with the value 1. You could also use that syntax to initialize it. You could also use that syntax. You could use that syntax. You could use auto, meaning the same thing, because the compiler deduces the type integer automatically, and all that good stuff. Here is also a nice GIF talking about the different kinds of initializations that C++ provides, and those are just a handful. I just let you have a look at it for a few seconds. But you should always use the most basic initialization. Later on, we will go into more details here. All right, so I guess you got the point. We are almost ready, almost done for today. One more thing I need to discuss in order for you to be able to work on the exercises, on the exercise sheet, because now we have to talk about I/O streams. So what are I/O streams? I/O streams allow you to interact with the outside world. That means your program is able to interact with the outside world. It is able to read some inputs, process inputs, and then you can output your inputs or your process data. So, and in order to use the I/O streams, you need to include the header file I/O stream, similar as we did for the Hello World program, where we outputted a string literal to the command line. So I/O stream is part of the STL, which is why you can just use it and the compiler will understand it. And the content lives in the namespace std. So please prefix your variables and your stuff that you're using from I/O stream with the std colon colon prefix, or use the using namespace std line here. And the important variables for now are cin, which is the standard input stream, which allows your program to read something from the command line, some data. Cout, we already observed cout in the Hello World program, so it's the standard output stream. And cr for standard error stream. And the C essentially stands for character output stream, because you're reading text and you're writing text to the output streams, usually. And then you also have a log stream where you can log some general information if you ever need to do that. And what you can then do is you can use the shift operators, so the shift left and the shift right operators, which are overloaded on those stream variables. We will later on talk about operator overloading, so you can overload the meaning of those operators, of the shift operators yourself, and assign different meanings to them. But they are overloaded on those streaming variables here. So let's have an example how you could use those trickery here. So using namespace standard, so we can avoid the prefixing. Let's create an integer variable by the name of I, and we assign initially, we initialize it with the zero, with the value of zero. Then we can print this string literal to the command line to see out. We print that to the console, to the command line. And then we are reading from the command line. So this line of code, this statement here, reads some stuff from the command line into the variable I. So the program now is interactive, so to say. It prints, enter an integer, then you could enter, for instance, 42 on your keyboard, press enter, and then whatever you entered is read into the integer variable I. And the contents of the integer variable I can also be printed again after that. So for instance, you can have a new statement here using cout, where you just print to the command line the value of I is, and then you use the variable I directly here, and meaning its value is essentially used and printed to the command line. So here you have a program which already does some input-output stuff, and in between you could do some useful computations using that data that you just read. That's the general idea. Here are some helpful Unix commands, because on the Linux system I provided in the virtual machine, you probably wish to use the command line all the time or wherever possible. I will show you an example in a second, but here are some useful command line commands that you could use on a console. So, recap for today. What did we talk about? Course outline. We talked about what C++ is. So we had those huge amount of bullet points, what different people say about C++, what it is. We talked about the history of C++. I presented to you compilers, GCC and Clang. And I also told you about the context, about the workings and concepts of compilers. So what is a compiler? What does it do? What's its job? And then we talked, of course, about compiler implementations that you can use. We talked about a Hello World program. We talked about built-in data types. That should be a T rather than a D, I just recognize. Information encoding, so different kinds of encoding depending on what data type you choose, so different semantics for the same bit string. We talked about variables, so variables have a type, a name, and optionally an initial value, and we also talked about undefined behavior, so be aware of that. And we talked about I/O streams, so how to get data into your program and how to output data from your program to the environment, to the outside world, so to say. Any questions? Haha, funny. So this is a place where you should go to the Panda Forum and ask any questions, and I'll try to answer as soon as possible, of course. But also your colleagues are allowed to answer questions, of course, if you know the answer and some of your colleagues has a question, please answer him or her. And now let me quickly show you the development environments that I'm using all the time. So VS Code, it's a small editor that I'm using when I write C and C++ code. It's already installed on the virtual machine. Let's write a Hello World program together, and I will show you some stuff, how it works. And also then I will quickly show you how to get a C++ job, because it's really that darn easy. If you know C++, you can really get well-paid jobs easily. And as a reminder, the password for the virtual machine is CPPP. That would be it lecture-wise. Let's switch to our IDE. So. Or IDE, it's not an IDE, it's a text editor. And you have the same text editor installed on your virtual machine. So where are we? Here is our console, which we can open, and we can have a look in which directory we currently are. So print working directory. So we are currently located in the following directory. And we can also list the contents of this directory. So ls shows you all the contents of the directory. The directory is currently empty. So let's create maybe a new file, so a new text file. So Control N for new file, and we can save that file. And I don't know, name it hello.cpp for instance. And let's write a small hello world program. So we now have created a C++ text file with the file ending .cpp that indicates that, hey, in this text file, there's actually some C++ source code. That's the meaning of .cpp. It's the very end of the text file. So in order to print something to the command line, output a hello world, we need to include the IOStream header file, of course. We can use using name, if one could type, namespace standard. So we do not need to prefix standard stuff from the standard library, from the STL, standard template library to be precise. We need a main function as an entry point. This is our program's entry point. So once this program is compiled into a binary, this is the first function that the operating system calls. That's basically where our program begins on its journey of execution. All right, so now we can use the cout variable and use the shift left operator, which is overloaded here. So we can shove whatever is on the right hand side of the left shift operator into that output stream. That's essentially the meaning. So let's have the string hello world / n for a nice new line at the very end. And then we can also have a return and tell the operating system, yeah, everything worked fine. So just return 0 to the operating system. So we save that file. And now we can call the compiler and have the compiler compile that file. As you see, if we list the directory's content, we now have a file by the name of hello.cpp, and we can now call clang, for instance. Setting the standard to C++ 17, enabling all warnings, specifying our source code, and dash lowercase o specifying our output, which should be a file named hello. So we execute that command, and the compiler has now, and you already see it here, the compiler has now created a binary file, or has translated this into a binary. If we once again list our directory's content, we now see another file called hello, and this is highlighted in green, meaning, oh, this file is executable. This is an executable file. And with ./, we can now specify this executable file and type press enter to execute that program. And oh, surprise, surprise, the program prints hello world to the command line, exactly as we wish to do. So that's basically how to write your own hello world program. Everything is pre-installed on the virtual machine, so please use it. All right, so last point for today is how to get a C++ job. Maybe that's interesting for some of you. So let's switch to our web browser here and go to stackoverflow.com. So I mean, Stack Overflow is not only a top forum for asking programming questions on C++ or any other language, really. You can also look for jobs. So let's go for jobs. Let's type what we can do after this course. Let's type C++ programming. And here we get some job offers, so some open jobs to which we can apply. So first hit is already quite nice. So C++ developer in Berlin. If you wish to go to Berlin and work at a company called ThinkCell, they pay quite good money, as you can see here already. So it's like up to 120,000 euros a year. So that's quite nice, actually. And here you can basically choose where you wish to live later on. You can go to Switzerland, you can go to Amsterdam and make up to 80,000 euros, 60 to 80,000 euros. Quite interesting job offers, and they all use C++. For instance, Flow Traders, it sounds like an automated trading system company. So actually, there are automated trading systems which are implemented in C++ to be as fast as possible. And those trading systems read all the stock market data, process this data in a mathematical model and then chooses buy or sell or buy stocks of different kinds. And the thing is, you must be fast, faster than all your competitors. And if you're fast enough, you can buy cheap and sell expensive. And that's basically the business model. I mean, from a morality standpoint, one might think that's not real work that has been done to generate money because no value was created. But what can you do? What can you do? What else can you do? Zurich again, Greece. So lots and lots of different exciting jobs, I would say here. Audio products. So if you're interested in music and good speakers and all that good stuff, you can work at Teufel or could apply for Teufel, the company, famous company. So really, really interesting. You can also have a compensation. So maybe let's say, yeah, we are good C++ programmers. We wish to have at least 80,000 euros a year. You can also filter here and only get the high paid jobs. I mean, maybe let's try to drive it even further. Oops. Let's try 100,000. And you will always find jobs that pay that much money. So that it's really attractive if you know C++ and are a good C++ developer. Lately I saw a job offer here like up to 400,000 euros a year. So I mean that's a word. So yeah, that would be it for today. I hope you enjoy that course. Other than that would be it for today. I will upload the next lecture on next Friday, of course. You can already find the exercise sheet online. And other than that, thanks and goodbye.